Jesus, you're the center of my joy. All that's good and perfect comes from you. You're the heart of my contentment. You're home for all I do. Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Jesus, you're the center of my joy. All that's good and perfect comes from you. Ooh, yeah, boy. You're the heart of my contentment. You're a hope for all I do. Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Me and a better, can you help me sing right here? Say,
Jesus,
say,
you're the center.
Jesus, on your face.
You're the heart of my contentment.
Oh,
for all I do. Jesus, you're the center of my joy.
When I lost my direction, you were the compass for my way. You're the fire at night when nights are long and cold. And sadness, you're the laughter, hey, that shadows all my fears. And when I'm all alone, yeah, your hand is there to hold. And that's why I say, yeah, that Jesus is
the center.
Nobody but you, Jesus. And your
home for all I do. Jesus, you're the center of my joy.
You are why I find pleasure in the simple things of life. You're the music in the meadow and the stream. You're the laughter, yes you are, of my children.
The center of my joy.
Can't nobody do me like you. You're the center of my
You got to live right.
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 You
Say right, do all these things right. But I'm going to tell you something, Satan going to give you some hiccups. I'm just saying, no matter how good you think you are, we always like to compare ourselves against somebody else that we know. We look at somebody and say, well, at least I ain't doing that. I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't dip, don't chew. But that don't make me better than you. Amen.
It is.
Father God, I come out in the name of Jesus to be used as your servant. I pray, O Lord God, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer, in Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. Because I do love the Lord. I love the True Spirit Church family. I love my pastor, the First Lady. I love those who may be visiting with us today, the musicians. I love every auxiliary of this church. Because sometimes without the church, I'd be totally lost. Now, I don't know if you understand that. But when you walk in this world and you've been down some roads I've been down, you appreciate knowing something about Christ. Somebody done told you about God. And it's a shame that somebody will grow up not knowing anything about God, Jehovah, or Jesus, the Messiah. I'm looking at today for a title is The Lord Will Provide. My text is coming from Genesis 22:14. The King James Version said, and Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. The New International Version says, so Abraham called that place, the Lord will provide. And today it is said, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. You may be seated. When the Lord put it on my heart to talk about Abraham and Sarah, I wonder, why was Abraham so special? Why God choose him? He chose him and he told him, said, get out of the land of your kinfolk, leave your country and go to a place where I will tell you. Being obedient, Abram got up, got his wife Sarah, got his nephew Lot and the family members, and they headed out, not knowing where it was going. God told him, I'll show you the place. And I figured it out that is that Abraham had this going from that he trusted God. Now, when he married Sarai, which her name was later changed to Sarah, that she was barren, she wasn't able to have children. And society during that time looked down upon women who couldn't bear children. Especially if you couldn't bear a man child. Because if you got a man child, he keep the name and the lineage going on. Help me,
Holy
Ghost.
Amen.
Abraham starts his journey. He comes upon Pharaoh, some Egyptians, and he gets scared. And he looks at Sarah and he says, look, I know you're a beautiful woman. You fair to look at. You just all of that in a bag of chips. And I love you. But now I'm going to ask you to do this thing. You tell them that you my sister. Don't say that you my wife, because they're going to kill me and take you. See, I need you to say this so I can live. Sarah says, okay. She's gone up in the house with Pharaoh in the palace. He didn't touch it because things started going wrong. He got a lot of plagues on him and all that. And Pharaoh jumped up and said, hold up, man, wait a minute. What is this you done did to me? Say, this is your wife. You told me she was your sister. You take her and you go your way. And look at here, you ain't leaving empty handed. I want to give you some sheep, some ox, some I'm going to give you some clothes. I'm going to give you some manservants, some male servants. I'm going to give you some money. Get on up out of here. So I wonder how did Abraham get rich. He said, well, he was very rich. God gave it to him. God gave it to him. But now, Abraham was 75 years old when God told him to leave his country. And God told him that he was going to have an heir to leave his wealth to. Long the time away, about 8-9 years had passed, and Sarah said to Abraham, said, look, maybe God meant to have a child through one of my servants. Maybe that's going to, because I'm way past childbearing years.
Yes, sir.
I'm old now, and, yes. And the things of a woman is gone. She said, take my maidservant Hagar and go in and live her up. Abraham didn't argue with her, he went on in there. Hagar conceived. 9 months later, she had a man child and named his Ishmael. Now, this is in the scriptures. I ain't making this up. You think I'm talking about some kind of soap opera here? I'm just saying, this is in the word here. And then we turn around, and then it was 14 years, but now Hagar was beginning to tease Sarah because Sarah was still barren and hadn't had no children. So she began to get on Sarah's nerves. Sarah said, look, Abraham, you got to put her out of here. She ain't going to be up in here with me. That boy of yours. He got to go. Abraham got up early the next morning, got some bread and some water. He wouldn't want to send away up to him. So he sent her out in the desert place. She was by herself. And it's dangerous for women to be alone them days with a child out of the wilderness. The angel of the Lord spoke to Hagar and said, what you doing out here? She said, I'm running away from my mistress. He said, well, I'm going to open your eyes and show you where some water. You go over there to the well and get some water. Then you go back to your mistress. But then God says to Abraham again, he said, I'm going to bless you, and your seed shall be a blessing to many nations. So when that happened, Abraham believed. I think Abraham was about 86 years old. Isaac was conceived. Abraham didn't have Isaac until he was 100 years old and Sarah was 90. So God is showing you that he has all power. Yes. Nothing is too hard for God. Amen. That's the moral of the story. Nothing is too hard for God. So if you trust God, yes, and believe that he is who he say he is, yes, and seek him, yes, diligently, you have to ignore leaning to your own understanding. When you look at your checkbook and say, well, I got $20 here, but I need to gotta pay a bill of $100 on, how am I gonna do this? And then I gotta go to church on Sunday and pay my tithe and my offering. And if I somehow it works. I can't explain it. My logic don't say, well, do this, it's gonna be. No. I remember my times in the military, I thought I had paid all my bills, paid my rent, went to the cemetery, got my groceries. Commissary got my groceries. Made sure the food on the table, bills all paid up. And I went to the bank one day, I had enough left over to get me a six pack, I was happy. I got to make that last between payday and payday, because when I first went in, you didn't get paid once a month. That's the new thing they come by where they give you something twice a month. Anybody talking to me now? So I went down to the bank one day, and that was over $120 in the bank. And I asked her, whose money is that? She said, well, that's your money, Mr. Taylor. For real? I get more than six pack now. Didn't tell the wife that we had a little extra money. God will provide. But now there was 14 years between Ishmael and Isaac. So God was telling Abraham, say, take Isaac, your only son. He didn't count Ishmael. He said, take Isaac, your only son, and make him a sacrifice for me. Right, right. Yes. Now remember, Abraham trusts God. Yes, right. He said, well, if he can have him born, and I'm 100 years old, and my wife is 90, I'm going to do this thing. Because if I kill him, God can raise him back up. Yes. Amen? Amen? So Abraham gets up early in the morning, he takes two of his servants with him, take a donkey, get some wood, get some fire, the coals of fire that he's carrying along, and he got Isaac going along with him. So they get along a piece of way, and God showed him the mountain where he wanted to go. And Isaac said, Dad, I see the wood. Yeah. And you got the fire in your hand. Where is the ram? Where is the sacrifice? Again, Abraham is showing faith in God. He said, God will provide. So he gets to the place and he tells the servants, he said, you two stay here and wait and watch. Me and the lad will go yonder and pray and prepare and worship. And we shall return.
That's right.
That's what Lord. So he trusts in God. Abraham is already believing that him and Isaac will come back down that mountain. He gets up there and he sets up the altar. Starts the fire. And he said, come here, Isaac. He binds him, he ties him up, right. Ties him down. And he puts him on the top of the altar.
Right.
He draws his knife. He's getting ready to slay his son, to whom he loved, to whom he had waited all his life for. But an angel of the Lord hollered, say, Abraham! Abraham! I have heard you and I see your faith.
That's right.
God bless you. Do no harm to the boy.
Amen.
He looked around. There was a ram hung up in the bush.
Yeah.
Had its horns hung up in the bush.
Yeah.
Abraham went over and got the ram from the bush and he came over and dressed him and sacrificed him. That takes faith.
Yeah.
Even in our own lifetime, when we run against financial obstacles, when we get fired off of one job, we're able to get a better job in the name of Jesus. Sometimes you look at it as a curse and a blessing all at the same time. You mad because you just got fired. But before you leave there, you're already calling on God. You say, now God, they done fired me from my job now. I need another. I need to provide for my family. 2 days later, you got a better paying job. Didn't have to work as hard. Talking about a ram in the bush. God will provide. He's a provider, I tell you. I heard a preacher say that there was a family that was a good family. They were working hard and the recession came along and they lost their job and he got behind on paying his mortgage payments and the bank began to foreclose on him. And they was preparing, they just knew, they was sad, they was praying, and they went up in the attic and started going through some old boxes. As they went through them old boxes, they found a magazine, and it was the first edition of Superman.
We'll work it out.
They took the book too, a magazine of praise, and it was the first edition. The book, valued at $250,000. Needless to say, they didn't have to move. Amen. They paid off the house. Had their bills to pay. God is a provider. You don't ever know what you got unless you can call on him. And if you don't know him, how can you call on him? If you don't know nothing about God, Christ, how he sent his only begotten son down.
Bless God. Bless God.
They put him on a cross. They nailed his feet. They nailed his hands. But they messed up. They set him up. They brought him up. They hung him out. He said, if I be lifted up. See, they going through their ritual. They gonna put the cross in the ground. Cross gonna stand up. They gonna make a mockery out of him up there for all the world to see. He dead. Satan, having a party. Oh, we got him now. Woo, we got him. They put him in a bar tomb. When something, you borrow something, you know you're supposed to give it back. You're supposed to give it back. I'm just saying. But then he said, in 3 days, I'll raise it up. And in 3 days, he raised it up. He did not lie. And he hung around for some 40 days after that. He ate with them. He had breakfast with them. He cooked breakfast for his disciples. Can you imagine God cooking breakfast for you? He is a servant. He's showing us how we need to serve. We need to cook for one another. We need to wash each other's feet. We need to say, hi to, how you doing today? Can I help you?
Yes,
silver and gold have I none, but look on me and I'll pay for you. I'll lay hands on you in the name of Jesus.
All right.
And just because you're a child of God does not mean that you're not going to go through some trials and tribulations. When everything is running smooth. Somebody says, always calm before the storm. You better get ready and be prayed up. Don't wait till something bad happens to get prayed up. You need to pray every day. Be ye steadfast in the name of Jesus. God is a good God, and he will provide for you no matter what you do. Get to know him. Get in a church that is teaching and preaching the unadulterated word of God. Get to know him. Sing some songs of praises for him. Get to know him. Serve him on the worship board. Get to know him. Serve him singing in the choir. Get to know him. Teach his holy word. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy. In Jesus' name.